9 years in the National Football League included a 2011 season in which he was the top rusher in the NFL. Mr. Jacksonville Jaguar, UCLA Bruin, and Northern California himself. Good to see you, Maurice Jones-Drew.
Good to see you as well.
How are you, MJD?
You know, I'm doing great. You know, I'm excited that you have all this.
Thank you.
This is wonderful.
I remember
you were such a small guy.
Well,
you weren't all this big time.
Well, you know, I'm 6 foot. You mean right. You're just talking about career stature? Is that what you're saying?
I mean, you seem quite.
What do you mean?
You know, you're sitting high.
I am. Well, I know. Get out of this chair. Hold on. Let
is
me help you out here for the radio audience. I'm gonna try and figure out where to do this thing. Hold on.
You have to deflate it.
There we go. I just deflated. I just took some PSI out of the chair. Is this better?
There we go.
Is this better? You and I are now eye to eye.
That's the guy I know.
Although I do feel like I'm Dorf. You know that the golfer, the Tim Conway guy who golfs on his knees.
Correct.
I feel like I'm the Dorf host right now.
Well, welcome to our world.
You're welcome.
The vertically challenged.
Well, I'm here now sitting much lower at the Rich Eisen Show desk with Maurice Jones-Drew sitting right across from me here. How is retirement treating you, MJD? How's
you know what? It has some good days and it has some bad days.
Which are the bad days?
When no one's at the house and I'm just sitting there playing video games.
You just by yourself?
Yeah.
But what do you... Okay, that's a visual.
Well, I've turned into a gamer now.
Which game?
Destiny.
Tell me about it. I have no earthly idea what this is.
I don't know how to explain it, but it's addicting. I have, like, guys that I play with. I get up at, like, 6 in the morning now.
Okay.
I get on the game. My wife's yelling at me. We're screaming at each other because they're all on the East Coast.
So you're on the East Coast?
No, they're on the East Coast.
Who's they? Your Destiny players? Like, dudes who are sitting in their underwear in their house?
They could be. I don't ask.
Ignoring their husbandly and fatherly duties? I mean, you've got 4 kids. What are you doing gaming at 6 in the morning? What are you talking about?
I can't sleep.
How old are your children?
My nephew's 8.
Yeah.
My son's 7. My daughter's 5. And my youngest son's 4.
They're all in the house?
And 3 dogs.
And 3 dogs?
And 3...
And yes. So it's sick. God bless your wife.
She's rolling, man.
So you get up in the morning and you're like, I got a vid. I got a game.
I have a problem.
And then yes, you do.
A Gamers Anonymous. That's where I need to go. But right now, I know I have so much time on my hands.
Yeah.
I figure why not
right.
Eat nachos and play.
No, God. You look great, man. You definitely.
Thank you.
You're very, very welcome. You're very welcome. So when did you say, look, this is it? I mean, I know we had this conversation, but now that we're face-to-face, right. Now literally eye-to-eye because I let down my chair. When did this all go down for you?
You know what? I was at school, taking classes, trying to finish my degree. And I would work out there Mondays and Tuesdays, and I wouldn't see my kids those days. And so one weekend, or I think right before I left to go to school, my son was like, are you gonna play football again?
Which son?
My oldest one.
Okay.
He's like, 'cause I kinda want you to, like, show me how you do it. Mm. And I'm like, well, I can show you and play. It's not that big of a deal. He goes, yeah, but then you have to leave in the summer for a month to train in Miami. And then he starts going through my whole schedule. And I was like, yeah, you're right. Then I talked to my agent about it.
Right.
And he was like, I think you got a couple more years left. And I always wanted to get out of the game healthy with some legs left. You know, you don't want to go out where everything's starting to fall apart a little bit. And kind of just decided after one class, you know, spoke with the Raiders. They wanted to go younger, but they still wanted me to be there a little bit.
Because Jack Del Rio's there. I mean, exactly. And you've known him for years. He was your coach in Jacksonville for pretty much your whole time there.
Yeah, but they, you know, they wanted to go a younger group, and it wasn't going to be a good fit. So I'm glad I played my 1 year in Oakland because I'm an Oakland Raiders fan.
Sure.
Right? Grew up a Raiders fan, so that was nice and got to see some family members. But it was time. You know, I got to... My oldest son is about to play tackle football this year. I get to be a fan. I get to sit in the stands and talk about everybody else.
I'm here with Maurice Jones-Drew here on the Rich Eisen Show. Are you concerned at all about your kids playing football?
Not at all. I think in anything you do, you want to have experience doing it, especially football because it's such a physical sport. And I tell parents all the time when they ask this question is that you don't want your son to start football as a freshman in high school going against guys that have played 4 or 5 years, maybe 6 sometimes, and they have that experience of how to get tackled, how to fall, how to keep their head up. You know, and your kid comes out there not knowing what's going on, and now these kids are much bigger. They're much faster than they are at 7. At 7, all you're doing is running into each other and falling down. I mean, there's no real serious injuries. And then also, you're teaching them how to hit. When you get to high school, it's not as much teaching as you have in Pop Warner. You know, the time limits, the restraints on that because of school and certain things like that. But at 7 years old, you can teach them the right way to tackle with your shoulders and how to keep your head up and keep instilling that in them for years upon years.
Then to dip at the hips and not bend at the waist.
Exactly.
Because if you dip at your hips, your head isn't what you're tackling. You're not tackling with the crown of your helmet.
Exactly. Look at you.
Oh, no, man. I mean, I've...
Are you coaching? Let's go into coaching.
By the way, I mean, I've seen some coaches around it. I wouldn't be too bad. I'm more of a rah-rah guy.
That's
you know what I mean?
Say.
I'm a rah-rah guy.
How about this?
Yeah.
I'll go to be a head coach.
Yeah, you do the X's and O's.
I'll call you.
Yeah.
You could be the life coach.
I could be the life coach.
The life coach. How to get better.
Yeah. I'll bring the kale juice, because kids dig that. Yeah.
That's where everyone's going to nowadays. I'm actually going to start.
Well.
Today's
Tuesday.
So I'm going to start tomorrow working out.
By the way, it was wise to do it after Tequila Monday. Because Tequila
always,
Monday, as you described in the television-only block, because you did that at the golf course with Jim Moore, for Jim Moore's charity golf tournament, you were there all day at Riviera.
Which is a great course.
Incredible.
I only have one problem.
What is that?
The grass grabs the ball too much for me.
Oh, man, it's the Kikuyu. The Kikuyu got
you. That's what they told me. What's going on?
Well, let me tell you about the Kikuyu, MJD. Words I never thought I'd say from this desk, let alone from the level that I'm sitting at this desk right now. That's Riv, man. You can't just knock it on there by rolling it on there.
Right.
You've got to throw your dart towards the hole, and then you got to be below the hole. Otherwise, it's a very long day.
So
that's the Riv right there.
I'm a knock and roll on type of guy.
That's no good.
No good. So I was putting from, you know.
So you've played a lot. You played too much golf in Florida.
And up north.
Yeah.
I get a little up north
okay.
up there a little bit. Florida, yeah, you could just, you know.
Yeah.
So I had to, the lawyers.
Yes, who you played with.
The group of lawyers that we were playing with. And there was one guy who was like a house dad, but his wife was a lawyer. So
yeah.
He was kind of.
Right.
Inadvertently a lawyer, I guess, in that situation.
Yes.
By the way, he's a middle school athletic director, which I heard is one of the best jobs going right now.
Okay, didn't know that.
Pay is phenomenal.
Figure that out.
Yes.
Okay.
But anyways.
Yes.
They were teaching me I had to punch it. You can't hit the high, you know, you got to punch it.
The lawyers were giving you tips. Let me ask you this question. Was one of the lawyers Ted Wells? Were you playing golf with Ted Wells yesterday?
I was not.
You were not?
Would like to meet the guy, though.
Would you? What would you ask Ted Wells if you got to meet him?
What is it like?
What is what like? What do you mean, what is it like?
To just investigate random
people?
Things for random reasons.
Air and bill millions of dollars.
Yes. What is it like?
What is it like?
How much you make per hour? I just want to know. Did you get
that
job?
How about I play Ted Wells? You play yourself.
Okay.
I'll play Ted Wells. Let's role play right now. Maurice
right.
Jones-Drew is you, and I will be Ted Wells.
This
go
is
for
my
it.
First. I might go into acting, too. This
go
is
for
my
it.
First one.
Excellent.
Yeah. Mr. Wells.
Yes, sir.
How does it feel?
Awesome!
Yeah. How much? Let's sit back and talk about
this. Let's do that. Yeah, MJD, sure.
How does it feel? I'm trying to do the leg up thing.
You can't do the
work.
Leg up thing. You
work.
Can't cross your legs.
I'm trying.
Your legs
are so big.
I'm trying.
You can't cross
you
his
see
legs.
That? I tried. I told you I was going to try. It doesn't work.
No, you
so
can't.
I guess I could just do a lower.
Careful.
Like this.
Don't hurt yourself, MJD. Because I'm not in that type of law.
I hear you.
See, I'm still role playing.
I got you.
See
right. Okay. Exactly. So, okay. So, whose text messages did you actually get?
All of them!
I only saw like a couple. I didn't see everyone's.
Yeah, you know what? Whatever.
Who is...
What? No, whatevs. Hashtag whatevs.
Whatevs? Hashtags?
Yeah.
So are you, when you retire... Oh, I got it over.
Yeah.
I got
you
it
did,
over.
You
just
did cross
barely,
your legs. Very good.
Barely over.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
When you do retire...
Yes.
Where are you going to live?
Oh, gosh. Let me tell you.
That hurt.
Here's where I'm going to live. I'm going to live in a very large mansion because what I do for a living is I bill a boatload of hours. And let me tell you something else about what I do. I inflate my rate.
That's every lawyer.
You betcha. By the way, very well done. Very, very, very well done role-playing.
I
think
you.
You've got his future in NCIS or CSI.
I'm a Law & Order SVU guy.
Are you really?
Yes. Benson & Stabler kind of get me my juices flowing at 6 a.m.
I love it.
Or Jack McCoy if I catch it on TNT.
My gosh.
On a Sunday.
You must be
you
a pleasure to get
the,
help get the kids out of the house in the morning. Maurice Jones-Drew is right here on the show. We'll be back in 60 ticks of the clock. We're done role-playing. I do want to ask you a couple of questions about running in the National Football League. And then we'll send you on your way.
Okay.
Maurice Jones-Drew is here at Jones underscore Drew 32 on Twitter, right here on the Rich Eisen Show, back in 60 ticks. Welcome back to the Rich Eisen Show at Jones underscore Drew 32. Maurice Jones Drew right here in studio. For those who don't know why you wore 32, have the floor, sir. Go for it. It's a cool story.
Coming out of college, I felt like I had done enough to be a top first round pick.
But you came out early.
I came out early.
A lot of people were wondering if you did the right thing by leaving UCLA early.
Yeah.
That I remember.
It was a little controversy, but, you know, my whole life has been like that. You know,
okay.
It's too small, this and that. But throughout my career, everyone always told me I couldn't do things. And I thought I did enough in college to grant at least a look at the in the first round, and I didn't. All 32 teams passed up on me. And so something for me to not get complacent throughout my career, mm-hmm. I wanted to wear, I was the number 32, so that every day I looked at it, it would remind me of that draft day, which was, it was like the best and worst day of my life ever. But, you know how that is. You had those days sometimes.
Well,
right?
No, I mean, I know exactly what you mean, where you're doubting everything, and it took a while, but you wound up in an incredible spot. I mean, the folks in Jacksonville absolutely adored watching you and embraced you in that city. And, you know, it was a great fit, obviously, for you. Fred Taylor coming
right
before you in that spot, and then you running the way that you did. Is there the hitting the ceiling at age 30 as a running back, is that a myth, or is there some truth in that, Maurice?
I don't think it's an age. I think it's more of a yards or mileage you put on. You know, for a while there, after Fred was and left and went to New England, I was running, you know, 1,200, 1,300 yards, 400 carries a season, 330 carries for about 4 or 5 years. That takes a toll on you, don't get me wrong. But you still have some guys. You have like a Rashad Jennings who's in New York. He's 30. We're the same age. And he probably has another 4 or 5 years left in him because his career started later on.
Mm-hmm.
Again, a lot of guys, you have these running backs that are coming out now and everyone wants to go in the first round. But if you do have a chance to sit behind someone and learn and then you kind of come in and can play after year two or three, I think that's the best situation because you get to see the positives and negatives of starting. Obviously for me, I got to see how Fred walked on Mondays. Like, all right, I got to figure out how to get my body back in shape. Or on the positive side, you know, you get a chance to learn how to play the game. The game is so different now from college to the NFL. It's crazy, you know, with these spread offenses. You see these coaches talking about it now. But these guys come in, they don't even know protections. They don't know how to anticipate holes, you know. And then plus the game's getting faster. So you have all these things going on. And you need to be able to play at a high level. You don't want to go in right away and then be considered a bust because you had two bad seasons your first two, you know.
And then but you're also seeing more of a premium being put on the younger running backs, where guys like DeMarco Murray, leading rusher, out. You, a 2011 leading rusher, retired.
Right.
I mean, you could keep seeing the number of guys who have the last time you've seen a leading rusher repeat as such was LT back in the middle of last decade. And now Dallas lets DeMarco Murray walk to Philadelphia, and Jerry Jones says the running game will be better this year with Darren McFadden, who you played with last year. What do you make of that statement from Jerry Jones, Maurice?
You know, I think that's definitely he believes in his team. I think, to be honest with you, I've been critical of the Cowboys during the draft.
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of people didn't like that. I said what I said about their first round pick.
What'd you say about their first round
pick? I just thought that that was a stretch to grab that guy at the mm-hmm. in the first round. I thought you could have mm-hmm. got him in the third or the fourth.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I mean, that's just my.
Well, they did that about Travis Frederick too. You know, I mean, a lot of people thought that they could have gotten him a while ago.
But the reason I say that is
Byron Jones had a great combine. Okay.
You know, you had a great combine. You know?
Yes, I did, sir.
Exactly.
Thank you for pointing that out.
I'm digressing.
At it.
But no, but so when you have a center, you know, there's not a lot of pressure on linemen.
Okay.
Right? Because you can move them around if they don't play well. You can do certain things with them. As a corner, we have to remember, as a first rounder, you have a lot of pressure on you, right?
Mm-hmm.
You are on an island right off the back. So you got to come in right now mm-hmm. and make plays. Now, you're talking about the NFC East. You have DeSean Jackson. You have Philadelphia Eagles. You have Beckham Jr. and Victor Cruz. I mean, you're going to have to be able to go out there and play. And I, you know, personally, I don't know if the kid can play. Or not. I've watched a couple plays on him, and mm-hmm. I've seen him. He was hurt a little bit last year. He had some injury issues, but I hope he does well.
Well, maybe if McFadden, you know, can chew the clock.
I think he will.
You do? You think he's going to do well there?
I personally feel like he can. You know, the Cowboys, what they've done the last couple of years is draft an offensive lineman in the first round, building from the inside out,
yeah,
is what I like to call it. I think that's the way you're supposed to build a team to be able to compete for championships. If you look at the playoffs every year, they have great offensive line and great backs. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Darren, his career kind of been up and down a little bit with injuries, but last year he was healthy. You know, he's been working his butt off. We talked a ton last year about what it takes to stay healthy and play at a high level. And I think he embodies that. You know, he's a guy, 4.3, 4.2 speed. Mm-hmm. He's big. He can anticipate cuts. And when he puts his foot in the ground, he goes.
Before I let you go, I'll give you the floor on Jim Mora, what he's done with your alma mater. What do you think?
I'm just ready to win a championship now. You know, we expect 10 games every year.
Uh-oh.
You don't have wood around here. Where's some wood?
Just here, knock on my head if you want. Here, lean over.
Okay. There we go. Uh-huh. But, yeah, we expect, I mean, the bar is, when I was there, we were 6-6, 7-6, 10-2, that we kind of went back down a little bit. He comes in 9, right? 10. Now we're expecting a Pac-12 championship. You know, getting that playoff system, let's see what happens. Mm-hmm. I'll definitely be around more, so I'll put my input in there when need be. But I think they have great recruiting classes year after year. They're competing to get some of the best players, and they're holding their players accountable. I think that's the biggest thing. You can get a lot of talented guys, but if you can't hold them accountable, then what are they?
Well, if you're going to be around more, that means you got to be in this studio more, okay? even though I got to be honest with you, throughout this entire conversation, I feel like I've been eating my knees. I can't wait to raise my chair back up.
You go ahead. You go ahead. I'm sorry.
I want to make my guests feel comfortable.
Since we went on that trip.
What are you? You're
trip
talking
to Rodeo Drive.
No, we didn't go on a trip to Rodeo Drive. You were there with your family.
You texted me, and we met up. It was like a tweet up,
right?
But it was like a text up.
Yeah, you were the one who had arms full of bags.
Oh,
and
no,
I had nothing.
Going in. You were coming out, and then the lady was.
But
like,
you had already gone all sorts of.
The
shopping.
Lady that was helping us had told us, like, do you know him? And I was like, you know, I don't know what you had going on. I didn't know what you were spending. I know you spent a lot of money. You had some bags in your hands. So I was like,
with my wife.
I'm going to let it be. I know what you were doing.
Yeah.
You always have to go get something at least once a week.
No,
I heard. I heard your tricks. I heard your rules.
Oh, gosh. No, listen, I've known you for a while. You can come back anytime. Seriously.
I appreciate it.
Certainly,
thank
if you can be part of the paparazzi, here too, will you please?
Got to.
@Jones_Drew32. Good to see you, Maurice Jones.
Thank you.
The Rich Eisen Show, weekdays at noon Eastern. On Audience.